Okay. Good afternoon and welcome to this newly appointed faculty member seminar of Humanitas University. Today I have the privilege to introduce you to Professor Silvio Danese, who is full professor of gastroenterology at Humanitas University since the 1st October 2015, but he has been working in the Humanitas Research Hospital since 2006 as head of the Infectious Bowel Disease Center in the Division of Gastroenterology. Professor Danese graduated in medicine and surgery at the Catholic University in Rome in 1999, and he did his residency in gastroenterology in the Policlinico Gemelli in Rome. And then he spent a few years in the laboratory of Professor Claudio Fiocchi at the Case Western University in Cleveland, Ohio, and he did a PhD in physiopathology there. His main research area concerned the investigation of the fundamental mechanisms underlying the pathogenesis of IBD, and also his daily clinical activity is related to this disease, of course. He is actively involved in many international clinical trials concerning IBD and IBD-related diseases, and has published more than 300 papers in international journals with an H index overall of 55. He's a member of many organizations related to IBD field, including the European Crohn's and Colitis Organization, where he was secretary from 2012 to 2015. And he's presently the scientific secretary of the International Organization for the Study of Inflammatory Bowel Diseases. He also sits in the editorial board of some important journals in the field, like GUT and Alimentary Pharmacology and Therapeutics. So I'm really pleased to invite Silvio to join me to the stage and to give his lecture, which will be entitled IBD in Humanitas or something like that. I don't remember exactly.
Yeah. Thank you very much, and good morning to everybody. It's a real pleasure to give, actually it's very nice what you said at the beginning. I've been here since 2006, and in reality we are celebrating next month. So it will be next month to celebrate 10 years of the opening of the IBD Center at Humanitas. But before telling you how we got to the 10 years and what we have done, I really would like to tell you why we start, or why I have personally started with inflammatory bowel disease. And in general, this is an interesting story. In reality, I wanted to be a rheumatologist. It's never too late, that's why now I'm working a lot with Carlos Elmi. But I liked always disease in which there is little knowledge. This is something that puzzles my mind all the time when we don't know what is it and what are the mechanisms for which patients are sick over time, chronically sick. This is something very puzzling. And of course, why from rheumatology to gastroenterology? Because one day I got in the endoscopy room and I loved endoscopy. It was so nice to look at endoscopy. And so I thought, I think there is a very good compromise to find something that is related to endoscopy and to research, to academic research. This is what was always of interest. And of course, why IBD? Because it was a perfect compromise between endoscopy and all these aspects that puzzle the mind of clinicians that look at these patients that have so many different conditions and that suffer so much over time from young age up to the age of 8 years. So let's, I think this is just to tell you why I picked in the GI field inflammatory bowel disease. And of course, something that has always been very nice for us and for our center was to try to move from mice, that means just mechanisms of inflammation in the gut, to men in trying to develop new drugs for patients, because these diseases represent a huge unmet medical need. Every time that you think about even the best drugs that we have today, they are able to bring patients into remission for 1 year, only 1 year when they start a very modern treatment, in about one third. So there is 70% of patients that keep suffering and keep undergoing surgeries over time. So these are hot areas that represent a huge unmet medical need. So this is the story. I have to start telling you that, as I said, we started in reality May 1st, translational center with a very strong basic science. Actually, this was the reason for which at the beginning I was recruited. And what is nice is this growth curve. When we came here, there were only 60 patients, very little patients number. This year, we have followed up in our center over 3,000 patients. So I think there was a big success in 10 years to have this tremendous patients coming to our center to get all the new or the best treatments for inflammatory bowel disease. And before telling you the scientific part, I want to start from the acknowledgments, because this cannot occur by myself alone, not at all. This is really due to many bricks that have, or many pieces of puzzle that have come together to make a very nice picture. So I tell you how I was recruited here. This is very personal. You know, I was in the States because this was in around early December, and I was sleeping. It was 3 a.m. at night, that in Italy is 9 a.m., and I got a phone call from Alessandro, as I said, the thinking endoscopist, and this was the first step. The first step was this phone call asking, why don't you come to give a lecture in our center? We are looking for somebody that does translational GI, and that was the start of everything. And actually, I have to thank Alessandro, not because of this first phone call, but because after, I think, 8 months, introduced me, my wife, and then the kids. So he had a major task in other aspects. And besides this, also a second big acknowledgement is to the institution, because when I came here, you know, the reason for which I didn't want to come back to Italy is because every time, and this is very frequent, every time that a medical doctor that has a strong interest in academic research wants to put his step in a hospital with a promise to have an academic career, this doctor will be phagocytated in the clinical routine. So at the end, we'll have never time to do research. So I said from the beginning of my negotiation, let's do 50% clinic and 50% research. These were the American standards, and I asked to do the same also here. And actually, you know, it's very, it was at the beginning, it was difficult to have this share of 50-50 between the clinic and the research. But I think that the referees of the institution were very good in helping us in achieving this equilibrium. So I think that the institution, for this commitment of having people doing translational research, is very good. It's a very good place where to do translational research and having protected time in the real sense of word to do research. So let's look at when I told you the bricks, without the bricks, all the people involved in these 10 years, we would have never accomplished the success that we achieved. So as I mentioned, we moved here, and the first huge brick was the presence of Stefania, which is really the big acknowledgement, because she runs really the lab, and the lab without Stefania will never be so smooth, and this has been keen. Of course, besides the translational part, what was very difficult at the beginning was to establish or to dedicate a unique IBD clinic, because generally this is something that never happens in the hospitals. Now there is big fashion, because now in 2016, IBD are under the major diseases of expansion, so there is a lot of interest in IBD. But in 2006, there was not so much interest for inflammatory bowel disease. There were very few centers around Italy. So what was key was to establish partnership with the patient organization. This was a key step, and to start with the first IBD nurse and with the first infusion unit for new drugs. This was key, because without a dedicated nurse, we could not develop what we have developed. And actually, what is interesting is that our model is now being expanded and exported in many other Italian centers. But I think we were the first to have a dedicated IBD nurse, especially for the trial unit and for the infusion unit. And then we got a second one, of course. Surgery. This, with the presence of Antonino, this has been the major step forward to expand the complexity of the patients. As I mentioned, what is key is that these patients over time require surgery after surgery, and collaboration between the medical doctor and the surgeon is a fundamental aspect of our practice. The combination therapy is really between medical and surgery, and having somebody that is proficient in this but also very reliable and very accessible has been something fundamental. And then, of course, with the dedicated radiology, with reading a lot, this has been also instrumental in trying to find a niche, particularly for the clinical research, which I will touch later on. And then these were the years of 2008, 2009. Then we expanded with the arrival of Jonathan. This was another big achievement, because without Jonathan, I could have not devoted to many other activities all the things that we have done. And then in the other years, of course, it was key to establish the global presence. This was achieved through ECHO with a lot of funding. We were able to get, and this I'm very happy for this, because this was a major milestone in getting funding from the States, from NIH, or big funding from you, in order to expand our group. And this probably was a way of increasing the basis for additional recruitment of other colleagues, and this has really helped us to move forward in the interest of research and also in clinical research. Of course, something that we have been able to expand with additional complementary activities for patients is the arrival of Mariangela with the ultrasonography. This has been very good. We have expanded the trial unit, because something that is very sexy, or something that is very appealing for the patient, is the opportunity to provide new drugs to them. Because as I mentioned you, when we have only one drug approved, one biologic with 25% of efficacy, and a 75% unmet medical need, there is a huge need of having new drugs, and these are accessible mainly through the clinical trials. So this has been a very nice activity. Latest, in the 2014, we got this very nice recognition in relation to the quality of the care that we deliver to our patients. We've been selected as an example of 8 or 10 centers across the world for the best practice for inflammatory bowel disease. And beside this, I think what the next challenge will be to export in the other two hospitals. And I think this is an activity that has already started and is becoming more and more substantial in Bergamo and in Torino. There is another nice step in latest in 2015 that is, beside the arrival of Federica, which is additional expansion of our group, is the start of the GI Epidemiology Center. This is my name. Of course, the hospital arrives, in my view, always late. When we get the things, then the hospital says, ah, good job, you got something new. But this is the recruitment of Stefanos, which is a key person for everything that is related to epidemiology and gastroenterology, and this will be an additional and complementary person that will provide a lot of expertise for us. And then the final nice thing, this is in 2016, we are trying to develop a very big network with all the GPs in the region for fast referral for inflammatory bowel disease. This is the activity of the red flags for early Crohn's to differentiate irritable bowel syndrome in the population. This is an experiment. It's done in a way of a clinical trial, but this will lead us as one of the top centers for recruitment for fast access for patients in the region. So I think this is fostering and integrating our center in the region. This was the first part, the personal story and all the bricks that we have developed in these 10 years. Now, let's talk scientific. And this is the overall activity of our lab or of our center. There are two major parts. The first part is mainly inflammation in the gut, a lot of preclinical work, some clinical work as well. And then the The second part is related to a lot of clinical trial or clinical activities that we do, and I will zoom into these to give you a flavor of what we are doing. So, but of course, as I said, the key word is translation. This is fundamental. So one of the first areas that we've been working over time is recruitment of leukocytes, how the bad cells or the leukocytes arrive to the gut. And actually, this has been very relevant for translation. Last year, we got the first drug approved. I will show you later on. But beside this, this was the major focus, I will say, a few years ago. We have focused on the second part now. We are looking on after the cells arrive in the tissue, how the cells can be helped to get away from the inflamed tissue. It's a different way of tackling the disease. So as I mentioned to you, a lot of attention at the beginning was devoted on understanding the mechanism of the bad cells to be recruited. And this is a way of stopping the bad cells to arrive to whatever is the tissue of interest. This is already a reality. Now we are thinking forward for the next years, and we are looking into how to help the bad cells that are still giving a damage in the gut to exit through the lymphatics. And in fact, this was a nice paper that was published by Silvia D'Alessio. This is in JCI, showing that there are lymphatics that are overexpressed in the gut of patients. You see that this is ulcerative colitis or Crohn's disease, and all these small vessels are overexpressed in the tissue, in the inflamed tissue. And actually, what is interesting is that basically you can play around. This is done only at the mouse level. You can overexpress the lymphatic by administering, for instance, a virus that overexpress a growth factor that is called VGFC in order to have more proliferation, or you can block the lymphatic giving a monoclonal antibody against the same, the receptor of the growth factor. But what is interesting is that this has a strong therapeutic potential, because basically if you can help the bad cells to have VGFC, you help the leukocytes to abandon the inflamed tissue and to improve intestinal inflammation, as you see here in these mice. And actually, this is very interesting because it's a way of giving an exit strategy to the leukocytes to leave the inflamed intestine. We are now working on the junctions, and this is very nice staining in 3D, looking, this is one lymphatic endothelial cell, and you see that all this green part, I'm trying to be very simple because we have some not experts in the field, but what is interesting is that all these green colors are basically the doors of the endothelial cells. And one of our hypotheses is that if we know what are the keys to open or close the doors, we can help in a way to adopt this strategy for leukocyte exit. But it's not only for leukocyte exit, it's also for cancer. This is an example. You know that metastasis occur through the lymphatic. And this is just an example of looking how the junctions, how the doors can be open and closed using some factors for manipulation, again, the VGF receptor 3. And you see that this is relevant for cancer metastasis because, of course, you can open the door and help the leukocytes to go away and improve inflammation, but you can think to close the door for cancer and avoid metastasis. So playing around with this could be very relevant, not only for inflammation, but also for cancer metastasis. Second area in which we believe there is a lot of attention is mesenchymal stem cells. And Stefania has just shown, this was published in Gastroenterology, that there is a big therapeutic potential. You see here that if you give stem cells, the mice improve. These are mesenchymal stem cells. But what is interesting is that you don't need to be topically administered. You can just give stem cells into encapsulated, for instance, spheres, and the stem cells will do their job secreting some factors that will help inflammation to switch off. It's very interesting because actually, it was 2 days ago, there was a big press release from a company. It's called TGenix. This company is the first company that is going to be approved for stem cell treatment for fistulizing disease. We will see where we will get this paper published. It's a big multicentric trial, but this is basically in line with this gastro paper showing efficacy of mesenchymal stem cell, and this is only for fistulizing Crohn's disease. And this is the story of Stefania. A third aspect in which we are working is resolution of inflammation. So a lot of research is just thinking of block inflammation. So anti-TNF, anti-L1, anti-cytokine X. But what we think is also relevant is to help inflammation to resolve with factors that are naturally expressed and that are also that need to look at. And this is an area of investigation that has very little attention in the field. And actually, this is an area that has been developed mainly by Federica and by Silvia. And looking at patients with ulcerative colitis, you see that there is a defect of many of the factors that are resolving agents. And what we believe, the reason for which we believe these pathways are very relevant is because chronic inflammation can be simply seen as a lack of resolution. So if we give mediators that improve the lack of resolution, could be therapeutically relevant. And there are examples already that are becoming a reality in clinical trials. So this is another area that would be very, very relevant. And we are working specifically on one factor, endothelial cells, that is a transcriptor factor, and we believe that this could be very relevant for translation by infusing endothelial cells that will home to the gut, overexpressing this unique factor for resolution of inflammation. An additional aspect we are actively working is all the pathway related to S1P, sphingosine 1 phosphate. You know, this is a drug that is already a reality for multiple sclerosis, but the reason for which we are very interested on this is not the simple story that everybody is showing. Don't I fear the slide, but basically the simple story is that this drug for multiple sclerosis is able to entrap leukocytes in the lymph node. Here we are working by dissecting all the receptors, looking particularly at some of them and their activity on the epithelial cells. For instance, this is very interesting. Already Stefania has shown that if you knock out specifically one receptor, these mice get more inflammation and more cancer, you see very clearly. So we are working not in the way that everybody is thinking, leukocyte homing or egress from the lymph nodes, but in particular on epithelial cells, which is of interest for the gut. And finally, an additional part is related to junctions. This was already a nice story, but now we are moving from the junctions on the epithelial cells to cancer, in particular with GEMA, and how the flora is relevant and is involved in making the cancer more frequent in mice, in this case, that have a defect at the permeability level. Because we believe that having a permeability defect will help the flora to penetrate more in the submucosa and to promote microinflammation, and this will lead more to cancer type. This is time, we'll leave it. Okay, we have a lot of other projects. As I said, we have 10, 12 doctors in the lab working actively. So that's why you see this huge list of projects that are related to lymphatics in many areas, a lot of pro-resolving mediators on the epithelium. But what is interesting is that now we are ended up even in liver biology, because obesity, flora are so related that we have phenotypes of mice getting NASH, and we are jumping into this area that is also related to gastroenterology. I don't know if we will get new funding for this, but this is very interesting how the gut and the liver are very much connected. Let's do the clinic. This is the second part. Just to give you a flavor, I'm not going here to present data, but just to give you an overview on the areas that we are working. And in particular, we are working in imaging, and this is thanks to our radiologist, in bowel damage progression. We are looking at several therapies or at data comparisons. So these are work mainly done by Jonathan, for instance, and Christiana. And this is looking at many aspects on how the damage of the gut occurs over time in patients with Crohn's disease and how we can actually block this damage. All the investigations here are done with radiology, so magnetic resonance. Another very key area, and this is work mainly done by Stefanos, is comparing data, big trials comparison, in order to understand which is the primary drugs that we should use or what is their safety profile when you compare in an indirect manner. This is a very nice paper that was published in Annals of Internal Medicine. Hopefully we can replicate in the next few days with a paper that is under review. We have a lot of clinical trials. Sometimes we are good in convincing companies of giving us the opportunity to leading the clinical trials. This is the example of anti-IL-13. Sometimes we are just co-authors, like for instance in this paper. When I told you that at the beginning we have had the opportunity to work with the first drug that is approved for blockade of homing, I was referring to vedolizumab. This is a drug that is coming in our practice in a couple of months, and these are the big papers that were published now 3 years ago in the New England, showing efficacy both in Crohn's disease and in ulcerative colitis. We have a lot of other studies in collaboration with other groups. This is methotrexate, published in Gastro early last year. We have papers showing a combination between azathioprine and infliximab. These are papers that are really changing the practice on the way we treat our patients. For instance, these are papers showing that combination therapy is the best strategy so far today, until we don't get new drugs. We have developed this. This we are very proud, because this is the Le Mans Index, was just published last year. This is a new way of looking at Crohn's disease for new endpoints for clinical trials. So this is promoted. I think we have been the second center in recruiting, not only for recruitment, but also in the implementation and in data analysis. That's why we are working a lot for this. Something that is we are very actively working, these are all the new endpoints. For instance, this is the IOIBD technical review on endoscopic indices, or all the histological indices. You see that all these papers are very recent papers, but basically our field is a field that is very much evolving, especially from a regulatory point of view, with the new endpoints to develop the proper drug with good efficacy data. So that's why we are very, very proud to be involved in this group that are technically mainly with IOIBD. This is a new initiative. This is the STRIDE initiative that was just published last year. That means that basically we should not treat anymore our patients just according to symptoms, but according to target, according to inflammation. A little bit like we are doing in cancer. And of course, these are recommendations that are implemented in clinical practice. So that's why we are very much happy to be involved in all these consensus that are, these are just example of consensus. So I think this is overall to give you a flavor of all the activities of our center after 10 years. We will see what will happen in the next 10 years, but for this, I think we have a huge pipeline for drugs for Crohn's disease. You see here, this was the pipeline of a picture that was taken in 2012. Actually, we have a new picture that should appear next year. We have a lot of new drugs that are moving, not only for Crohn's disease, but also for ulcerative colitis. So I'm sure that we'll have a lot of new, exciting drugs for our patients, as I mentioned at the beginning. And once again, I want to thank all the group that is really fundamental for the success of our team. Thank you for your attention.